The most important thing that you personally can do in revival is believe what Jesus did on the cross, he did for you. And that's what you have to believe just in order to get saved. But what happens when you got saved, things would be great, you're in love with Jesus, and all of a sudden you start falling in love with the things of the world, and you start doing the things of the world, and you do worse things of the world, and you start living your life and having the same attitudes the world does, and all of a sudden you realize, am I even saved? So what do? You confess your sins to him. Confession is homologeo, Greek word that means say the same thing that God says. You call sin what God calls sin. You call what you have done that God calls sin, sin, which means you're taking ownership of all the bad stuff that you've done and thought and said. And you tell God, I have said and thought and done what you are calling sin, and I am the sinner. Because he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of all righteousness. That's the most important part of repentance, is believing what Jesus did on the cross, he did for you. It's the most important part of repentance. Yes, repentance is turning, you know, repentance is metanoia. It means thinking a different thing. It means a change of mind. And as your mind has changed, it is shown by 180 degree difference. You were going that direction and God's back there, and I turn away from that and I'm going back to that. It's shown by what you do. It's shown by what you say. It's shown by how you think. That's metanoia. That's change of mind. Then comes the confession and belief that you have been forgiven. Mm-hmm. We don't live in a state of have mercy on me, have mercy on me, have mercy on me, have mercy on me, and trying to make yourself feel so bad and kicking yourself around the block so maybe you'll be sorry enough to finally never do that sin again. Does that ever work? Nothing changes until you have believed that what Jesus did on the cross, he did for you. And that's what they're doing right here. They're making atonement for all of Israel and they're making atonement. We get atonement. Our blood, the blood of Jesus atones for us. But it's more than just atonement, because Jesus is a propitiation for our sins. Just go a couple more verses after 1 John 1:9, you're going to get to 1 John 2, verse 2. He's the propitiation for our sins. He took God's wrath. He took God's punishment and appeased God by bringing justice. Justice happened on the cross. He did that for us. He's our propitiation for our sins, and not our sins only, also the sins of the whole world, which means anyone can come to Jesus and ask for forgiveness, and God won't give them the judgment that he's promised. He will relent from it. It says it right here, and the Lord relented concerning the doom which he had pronounced against them, and God will relent from the doom he is concerning what was pronounced against us, and concerning the doom pronounced against anyone if they turn from their sin. If they believe what Jesus did on the cross, he did for them. They confess their sins. He is faithful and just to forgive them of their sins and cleanse them from all unrighteousness. It's more than just atonement, which is just covering. God wouldn't see the sin because it's covered with the blood of that innocent animal that was slain. But Jesus is the propitiation. He takes it away. He takes away, once and for all, he took away the sins of the world. Now, whoever thirsts, let him come. Whoever is hungry, come, let him eat the bread of life freely. Whoever, whosoever, there's a whole bunch of whosoever's out there. Every one of us who believes in Jesus Christ is one of those whosoever's, because we believe in what Jesus has done for us. That is what does revival. Because we were dead in our transgressions and sins, we had to be revived. We had to be made alive. And we're made alive. God gives us new life. Okay, verse 25 of 2 Chronicles 29. And he set the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals and psalteries, with harps, according to the commandments of David and Gad, the King Seir, and Nathan the prophet, for so was commandment of the Lord by his prophets. And the Levites stood with the instruments of David, and the priests with the trumpets. And Hezekiah commanded to offer the burnt offerings upon the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord began also with the trumpets and with the instruments ordained by David, king of Israel. And all the congregation worshipped, and the singers sang, and the trumpet sounded, and all this continued until the burnt offering was finished. And when they made an end of offering, the king and all that were present with him bowed themselves and worshipped. What's the next part of revival? Worship. You can't worship God with your sin. He's not going to listen to your prayers. He's not going to listen to you. If your heart is far from him, he's not going to listen to anything you have to say. I don't care how professional a musician you are. You're standing in front of people, you're supposed to lead people in worship, and you don't have a right relationship with Jesus Christ, you're not leading anybody. You're just leading a gigantic lie. No, the first thing's got to come first. The things that you know to do, you got to get rid of. That's part of repentance, is turning away from your sin, getting rid of those things that can have any influence, the cleansing of your own temple, getting rid of all those things that would be an infatuation of anything but the Lord Jesus Christ. And then getting real absolution, total cleansing from the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all of our sin. That's when worship can happen. The moment that your sins are forgiven, the moment that you know that the doom concerning you that was pronounced against you has been lifted. The moment you know you're not going to go to hell like you deserve, but you get to go to heaven. The moment you know that Jesus loves you enough to die on the cross for your sin. The moment you know that you've been restored in relationship with God the Father, and you call him out, Daddy, Father. When there is complete reconciliation, what's going to happen? You worship. That's what happens. You worship. I mean, a lot of people are trying to force people into worship situations, and they're not right with God. And God's angry with them because they're still in their sin. They can't worship. But they look around and see other people, and they're in tears, and they're loving on their God, and they don't get it. They know that there's something real going on. But what's going on in their heart is they're still a rebel against the holy God. They still love their sin, and they don't want to change. And God can't accept their worship. Verse 30, moreover, Hezekiah the king and the princes commanded the Levites to sing unto the Lord with the words of David and Asaph the seer, and they sang praises with gladness, and they bowed their heads in worship. Then Hezekiah answered and said, Now ye have consecrated yourselves unto the Lord. Come near and bring sacrifices and thank offerings to the house of the Lord. And the congregation brought the sacrifices and thank offerings, as many as were of a free heart burnt incense. Okay. I'll read it. And the number of the burnt offerings and the congregation brought was 70 bullocks and 100 rams and 200 lambs. And all these were for burnt offering to the Lord. And the consecrated things were 600 oxen and 3,000 sheep. Okay. What's the next thing that happens? Real relationship with God. The thanksgiving offering is true communion with God. When there's a thanksgiving offering, it's not just the burnt offering of sin, where the thing is completely burned up to God. It's all God's. And no, this is having relationship with God, because some of it is burned. Some of it is that meat is now prepared, and the priest and his family, who are in a state of consecration, of sanctification before God, can eat it. And you who have brought that offering, and your family, who are also in a state of consecrated holiness, can eat it. So you're eating it. It's like you're enjoying a meal with God. It's like having God do your barbecue, so to speak, if we want to think about it. Only it's a holy affair. It's not everybody just goofing off and hanging out in a park somewhere. This is real communion with God. That's the real thing. This is real fellowship with God. That gets restored. That goes on. Real fellowship with God. That's our continued relationship with God. We call this communion. I know that word comes from the Greek word koinonia, which is the word for sharing. And we call it communion. So we are sharing with each other what God says to do. And he says, do this, what? In remembrance of me. It was no longer part of the Passover where you are remembering God rescuing you from Egyptian captivity or our captivity to sin. Now it's remembering what Jesus did for us so that we can share our life with God. Beyond the worship service goes the next step, and that is what? Communion with God. As we walk in the light, as He, Jesus Christ, is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. That's real, genuine Christian fellowship. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all of our sin. Real fellowship, real, genuine Christianity, real fellowship with each other. It doesn't happen until all these other things have happened first. That's the next step in revival, which means you have fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, the rest of the book of First John is dealing with our relationships with each other. And it's a test to see, are you really of the faith or not? Because if you're really of the faith or not, what are you going to do? You're going to love the brethren. You're going to love your brothers and sisters in Christ. They're going to be closer to your own immediate family members. Okay, verse 34. But the priests were too few, so that they could not flay all the burnt offerings. Therefore, the brethren, the Levites, did help them till the work was ended, until the other priests had sanctified themselves, for the Levites were more upright in their heart to sanctify themselves than the priests. And also the burnt offerings were in abundance, and the fat, and the peace offerings, and the drink offerings for every burnt offering. So the service of the house of the Lord was set in order, and Hezekiah rejoiced, and all the people that God had prepared the people for the thing was done suddenly. Okay, let's talk about revival. What happened? The people who are born for the job aren't ready for revival. I have to say that. When you look at this COVID shutdown, what happened? All these churches are closed everywhere. Were these guys ready for revival? No, they were just as happy to go spend their time getting the salary from their church and writing their book or their memoirs or who knows what they're going to do. They were happy not to have to prepare something every week or whatever they have to do. I don't know what these guys have to do. They're hirelings, you know. They've shown themselves to be hirelings. I mean, really, when you look at what's going on, if revival had happened instead of COVID, there wouldn't be enough people to take care of what God is going to do. These were priests. They were the ones who weren't just, they weren't just only a Levite. They were descended from Aaron. They were the ones who God had made them born for that position to be a priest. They weren't just somebody who's there taking care of the buildings and grounds and making sure everything is working so that the priest can do their job before God. No, those people, the deacons, had to start doing the pastoring because the pastors weren't ready. They weren't sanctified. Well, I understand. Yeah, the culture kind of changed things. You know, you got Ahaz and everybody is doing their own thing with all these different gods. And you better really open up your mind to the way culture changes. You know, we really have to understand the culture. If we really want to touch these people, if we want to minister to people, we can't be just, you know, so focused on like God's word or something, or really think like maybe Jesus, you know, whatever. I mean, it's all about taking care of people. And it's not about... If revival would have happened instead of COVID, the same churches would have been closed as are closed now, because the priests weren't ready for revival to happen. What we got is a snapshot of these priests who weren't ready, and we saw it with our own eyes. Lots of other cheap people in persecuted countries, you know, they're not allowed to worship either. So what do? They go out in the snow someplace or out in the woods someplace. Somebody's got to get baptized. They cut a hole in ice and they get them baptized. And I've heard stories from your pastor where a bunch more people had to get baptized and he wasn't ready. And he had these pains in his legs. And he told his wife when he comes back, you know, make sure you got a hot bath ready because I'm really going to be hurting. And so... They got a hole in the river, and he's baptizing far more people than he could imagine. He didn't understand there's going to be these many. And so he was in the water for a few hours, this ice cold water. And he gets out, and he was, you know, and while he's in there, being obedient to what God told him to do, God heals him. And he didn't need a hot bath. He was fine. He never had the pains in his legs again. Yeah, wow. These guys weren't ready. They didn't care about who they were supposed to be serving. So when revival shows up, what happens? God's going to use somebody else. Here's these deacons, right? I mean, when you think about it, these guys love the Lord. They're kind of sacrificing their own time with their own family so that they can make sure the house of God is ready for the people, and they're taking care of the people's needs, and, you know, they're trying to encourage people all the best they can, you know, and the revival shows up, and pastors aren't ready for it, so the deacons have to do it. Deacons are doing it. They're not getting paid to do nothing. I just got to tell you, we got a snapshot of what would happen if revival happened and what churches would not exist. When revival happens, it's not about the people who got all the nice everything, who got it all in place, who got their nice programs happening, who've been using, you know, methods to start businesses to get their churches functioning. The people who are going to be used in revivals are the folks that nobody really knows about, but they've been praying for people. They've been on their knees for people. They've been fasting for revival to happen. And God says, here you go. Mm-hmm. I'll give you the power to do what I want you to do. Mm-hmm. Priests weren't ready. Are we ready for revival? Are we in a place of sanctification? Have we sanctified ourselves? Are we ready today if revival would happen today? Have we sanctified ourselves? Have we gotten rid of all those things that are yucking up our lives, that are mucking up our lives and our testimony? Are we getting rid of thoughts and flesh patterns and all the things that would hurt the testimony of Lord Jesus Christ? Are we giving Jesus our undivided attention? Are we sanctified? Are we set aside for God's use only? You know, God sanctifies me a little bit different than God sanctifies you. I'm doing what he's calling me to do, and it's going to be completely different what God's going to call you to do. And if you're sanctified, God's going to move you and use you how he wants you to be used. But if we're sanctified, we get used. It doesn't matter. And what does it say in 1 Corinthians? He uses foolish things. Mm-hmm. The people who don't have their degree or pedigree or anything. That's who he uses. The ones who will really look kind of ridiculous as far as the intellectual community is concerned. You know, the people who were historically used in revivals really did not have a good control of their own mother tongue. You know, I mean, when you think of D.L. Moody, he had a fifth grade education or something. I mean, he didn't, you know, some of these people who got used in revivals, they weren't intellectual geniuses. Mm-hmm. You know, now there were some intellectual geniuses that God used. But it wasn't until God brought him to a place of brokenness. You know, John Wesley was an amazing man of God, but he wasn't usable until he finally realized that Jesus died on the cross for his sins. Holy Spirit had to move upon him, and he had to realize that he was going to go to heaven when he died. I mean, a lot of people, you can say, okay, if Jesus comes today and you got to stand before him, are you gonna go into heaven? And you can say, okay, if Jesus came today, yeah, today, I'm good with God today, yeah. Are you going to go to heaven when you die? And they'll go, I hope so. That means you're not living or don't care to live a sanctified life. It's a big deal. If you care to live a sanctified life, you'll care to live a sanctified life today. You'll care to live a sanctified life tomorrow. And the next day, and the next day, and the next day, because you're in love with Jesus. Mm-hmm. These guys weren't ready. And they missed the biggest revival of their time. They missed out. I don't want to miss out on this next one. Oh, there's going to be a next one? You know what it takes to have revival?
Persecution.
Really bad stuff happening. When Hezekiah took office, what did he have to deal with? A country that was about ready to be taken over by Assyrians. A country who was following as much pagan stuff as true Yahweh, Jehovah worship. They were having alliances with stronger countries than them, hoping that maybe somebody could come and help. They weren't trusting God. They really, you know, like Ahaz, he cut a bunch of stuff out of the altar, out of the temple, whatever had any value, and gave it to Tiglath-Pileser. Did it please him any? No, it didn't. He said, forget it. I'm not going to help you guys. You're not worth anything to me. You don't have anything to offer. And Hezekiah rejoiced, and all the people that God had prepared the people for, the thing was done suddenly. When God does it, it's sudden. Are we ready for sudden? In the 60s and 70s, there was revival in America, and it was happening in the young people who basically had been abandoned because people were following the American dream after the Second World War and, you know, going for all the good things that America had to offer, and they'd forgotten about God. Yeah, churches were still happening, and churches all had their programs, and the young people were listening to all the really strong influences that were coming their way, like the Beatles and all these other philosophies and Eastern religion and everything that was coming in. And then you got the Vietnam War, and the men are coming back with more drugs and more Eastern philosophies, and people were just trying everything. And it wouldn't have taken very long before we would have been a completely godless post-Christian culture. But God interceded. With all that stuff and the Marxist invasion that was coming into America with all the, you know, Black Panthers and all these other riots that were going on back then. Is there anything different than right now? We got the same Black Panther riots, only it's called Black Lives Matter. We got the same Antifa riots that was going on, the same as at Weather Underground back then. I mean, all the same crazy stuff that's going on then, we got it all going on right now. Where people are afraid to go to downtown anything because somebody might be starting a riot somewhere. I think we're in the perfect spot. How about drugs? Is there less drugs now than there was then? You know, you've got marijuana is being legalized in all these states, and you got all these people who can legally get it from any shrink will write the thing, and you can get your, you know, your designated card. And, you know, the drugs are very high quality and are very powerful. And now, because there was some problems with China and not as many opiates were able to come here, now they're making these synthetic opiates, and now people are dying left and right. Every day you hear about somebody else dying. What's it called? Synthetic opiate. I forget what it's called. These people are dying of it all the time now.
Oxycontin?
No, a synthetic one. I forget the name of it. But people are, you know, people are dying from this thing because there's just as many drugs and they're stronger. I mean, you know, the pot that was around in the 70s was like the Cheech and Chong pot. The stuff they got now is really purified. And some of these people, at every shift, this one lady from the hospital in the ER says, every shift somebody shows up with this thing called squamating, which means they're screaming and vomiting at the same time because they never tried this pot before and it's so strong they're freaking out. And so they have a special word for it now, and it happens like at every shift. Because that's how we got a perfect scenario for revival to happen. And we've got, you know, a bizarre thing happening with an election, and it doesn't matter who wins, I guarantee it's going to be followed by a whole bunch of insurrection and chaos and, you know, Antifa and you name it, they're going to be going gangbusters, not just in the 8 states where it's happening right now, but in all the states. So people keep looking around for a stack of bricks to be delivered to some downtown area because they know there's already a plan for it to happen there. So it's bizarre. It's just totally bizarre. Are we ready for revival yet? Well, maybe we're not on our knees yet. Revival's not going to happen until we are desperate as a church for it to happen. Chapter 30, and Hezekiah sent to all of Israel and to Judah and wrote letters to Ephraim and Manasseh, that they should come to the house of the Lord to Jerusalem to keep the Passover unto the Lord God of Israel. For the king had taken counsel and his princes and all the congregation in Jerusalem to keep the Passover in the second month. For they could not keep it at that time because the priests had not sanctified themselves sufficiently, neither had the people gathered themselves together to Jerusalem. And the thing pleased the king and all the congregation, so they established the decree to make proclamation throughout all Israel from Beersheba even to Dan, that they should come to keep the Passover unto the Lord God of Israel at Jerusalem, for they had not done it of a long time in such a sort as what was written. So the post went with the letters from the king and his princes throughout all Israel and Judah, according to the commandment of the king, saying, Ye children of Israel, turn again unto the Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, and he will return to the remnant of you that are escaped out of the hands of the kings of Assyria. And be ye not like your fathers, and like the brethren which trespassed against the Lord God of their fathers, who therefore gave them up to desolation, as you see. But be ye not stiff-necked as your fathers were, but yield yourselves unto the Lord, and enter into his sanctuary, which he has sanctified forever, and serve the Lord your God, that the fierceness of his wrath may turn away from you. For if ye turn again unto the Lord, your brethren and your children shall find compassion before them that lead them captive, so that they shall come again unto this land. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you if ye return unto him. So the post passed from city to city throughout the country of Ephraim and Manasseh, even unto Zebulun. But they laughed to them to scorn and mock them. Nevertheless, divers of Asher and Manasseh and of Zebulun humbled themselves and came to Jerusalem. And in Judea the hand of God was given them one heart to do the commandment of the king and of the princes by the word of the Lord. What's the next thing that happens in revival? Evangelism. That's it right here. Where did Hezekiah send this report? We're going to worship God. We're all going to come together and we are going to partake of the Passover. We're a month late, but we're going to do it right now. And where did he send this? Just to the people who is in charge of him, because he's king and he tells people what to do. Goes to Ephraim and Manasseh and Zebulun and Asher. Yeah, what's he saying? All over. Mm-hmm. All of God's chosen people. All the land, everywhere. Quite interesting. The next thing that happens is evangelism. Evangelism, what we normally see is you got one guy in the pulpit and he's preaching, you know, and people bring all their friends to some big evangelist thing and they're all going to come and they're all going to hear and all that kind of stuff. Is that what was originally God's plan? I mean, it's great if you got a great preacher to have a big venue. I understand it's a great thing. But the command wasn't to the pastors. It was to all the disciples. Make disciples of all nations. That means everybody. Now, some people were sent out. Those people are called missionaries. Apostles, sent out ones. They're sent out. It happened in the Christian church. The apostles got sent out all over the place to give the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But everyone gets this command to share their faith. Well, this went to everywhere. Well, you know, the northern tribes have been apostate for a long, long time. You know, now they're gone. Assyria took them captive. The people who were left there who were Jews were the ones who were, you know, weak or poor or whatever to help the folks who, you know, Tiglath-Pileser brings in or whatever. You know, I mean, all these people are gone, but the people who are remaining, they could still come back to God. They could still come back and go to, it might take them a couple of days, but they'll get to Jerusalem and they'll be able to worship the Passover, turn their heart back to God. This was an evangelistic plea. I mean, as I was reading it, it's like, don't be stiff-necked like your fathers who brought upon God's judgment already upon you. It's already happened. You're living in a desolate situation because you turned away from God. Turn ye again unto the Lord. Your brethren and your children shall find compassion before them that lead them captive. God's going to be gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you if you return to him. Part of the gospel is not just turn or burn. It's we've got a gracious, merciful God. Mm-hmm. You turn to God, and God will turn to you, and will have compassion, will have mercy. We have a merciful God. Paul says that it's his kindness that brings us to repentance. There is a kind God who is willing to forgive, who is compassionate, who has mercy. He is there to receive in mercy anyone who turns to Him. But people don't want to turn to Him because they like their wicked way. They like their sin. They want to continue to do their sin. And that's what, you know, in John 3 makes it really clear. You know, back to Jesus talking to Nicodemus. He that believeth in Him, in Jesus Christ, is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is a condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. People who don't believe in Jesus Christ, God's wrath is still on them. 36 of John 3, he that believeth on the Son hath eternal life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. They who haven't turned back to God are still under God's judgment. And this plea goes out, and they sent missionaries, they sent evangelists all over the land of Israel. Even though it was taken over by the Assyrians and all different kinds of other people from all other countries, that Assyria stuff over there in their land were there, they're talking to the Jews and trying to bring back people to God. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you if ye return unto him. And they sent these things all over, even to the farthest north part of Israel. Nevertheless, divers from Asher and Manasseh and the end of Zebulun humbled themselves and came to Jerusalem. A bunch of people took this seriously, and they came to Jerusalem. They understood. They humbled themselves. They weren't full of their pride. Well, I'm not going to go do that thing. You know, I'm not going to go down there. No, they humbled themselves, and they went forward. I mean, you know, you can go to a big presentation of the gospel, but if you still stay in the back and go, yeah, sounds really good, must be nice, you know, or they legs feel frozen, or what they're afraid of is the hypocrisy of all the people who they thought knew, they thought they had proved to them that they were Christians, but they're not going to go forward, you know. They thought that they had snowed everybody that they're Christian. They can live with the Christians. They can have all the Christianese. They can say all the nice, you know, positive, encouraging words and all that. And, you know, they don't have a heart for the Lord. And they're not going to go forward. They got their pride. Well, these people humbled themselves, and they came to Jerusalem. That's quite interesting. Quite humiliating having to go do that. Why? Because you can't go and worship God in any other place. That's where it has to be, which means you're going to break away from your own culture. You're going to break away from everything that your family had ever told you, for everything that your country ever stood for. But everything your country stood for was in opposition against God anyway. So they humbled themselves, and they came to Jerusalem. And also in Judah, the hand of God was to give them one heart to do the command of the king and the princes and of the word of the Lord. What was this? God gave them one heart. What happens next in revival? Unity. A lot of people try to put unity ahead of time. They want to put it before all the rest of this stuff. So, you know, now what happens? Well, now truth takes a back seat, and the authority of God takes a back seat. And they're going to have unity at all costs. No, unity shows up once revival has happened. Why? Now you get the same tuning fork, and you tune 100 pianos with it. All those pianos are automatically in tune with each other because they were all tuned to the same tuning fork. That's where unity happens. You don't force unity to begin with. Oh, we'll just agree to disagree. Well, what are you going to disagree to? You're going to disagree to absolute truth. That's what you're going to disagree to. And you're going to agree to some low compromise. Well, that's what got you in the state of needing a revival to begin with. Now, once revival happens, now comes unity. Now it comes. That's the result. Verse 13, and there assembled at Jerusalem much people to keep the feast of unleavened bread in the second month in a very great congregation. And they arose and took away the altars that were in Jerusalem, and all the altars for incense took they away and cast them into the first Kidron. So they had this big old junk pile full of pagan stuff in that arroyo there, or Kidron was. And they killed the Passover on the 14th day of the second month, and the priests and the Levites were ashamed and sanctified themselves and brought in the burnt offerings into the house of the Lord. So what happened? The people who weren't ready, they were ashamed. They weren't ready when God moved. They were ashamed. And that's going to happen. When revival was happening in some of these churches, you know, nobody thought twice about Chuck Smith and Calvary Chapel or Jack Hayford and the Way and the Church in the Way. I mean, nobody cared about these places, you know, until revival happened. Now they're packed. They're full. But when revival was happening, it went into every church, every single church. All the churches got young people back into them because God was moving and answering prayers. Mostly prayers of grandmothers. They saw what had happened to their country. They saw what happened to their grandkids. And God said yes. And these pastors were ashamed. They weren't ready. They weren't ready to receive these people who wanted to serve the Lord. Because they themselves probably still need to be converted. They themselves were in their little box, doing their little thing, following their little lectionary, doing whatever it is that's written in the book, memorizing whatever some previous, you know, sermon writer had come up with so that they have some nice, easy to understand and easy to listen to homily for everybody in church to listen to. Here comes these young people. They got saved. They're in love with Jesus. And they start showing up and they want to praise Jesus with the music of their time. And contemporary Christian music was formed. And now these folks don't know what to do with it. Because they're like worshiping in a different language than we got. We got to sit here on our hands with a hymnal on our lap. And that's called worship. And it's got to be, you know, it's got to be very reserved. And here are these people who are just in love with Jesus. And they don't care about sitting on a pew somewhere with a hymnal on their lap. They're going to tell Jesus how much they love him. They weren't ready. They were ashamed. These pastors in the 70s were ashamed because these young people were in love with Jesus more than they were. They didn't understand. They didn't get it. Next time when revival happens, Lord willing, it'll happen. We keep praying. And a lot of these hirelings are going to be ashamed. You know, they were ashamed because people were knocking on the door at 9/11. Open the church, we got to pray. The pastors were ashamed. They shut down the church with COVID. The congregation are going, open up the church. We want to worship God. They're worshiping God in China, and it's illegal, and they get killed for doing it. But you won't open the church? And the pastors are not being ashamed because they're taking the government's money. Shame on them. But they're going to stand before Jesus and be ashamed. But the Levites were ashamed. They sanctified themselves, and they brought the burnt offerings to the house. They got sanctified. They got turned around. Revival finally happened in the pulpit because they were ashamed because the people who they thought they could care less about God got saved. Verse 16, and they stood in their place after their manner according to the law of Moses, the man of God, and the priest sprinkled the blood which they received on the hands of the Levites. For there were many in the congregation that were not sanctified. Therefore, the Levites had charge of killing the Passovers, every one of them that was not clean to sanctify them unto the Lord. They're sprinkling the blood. It's all the people need to get sanctified. What's the job of the pastors to tell people it's the blood of Jesus that cleanses your sin? If you don't hear it, if you don't understand it, then you think you gotta do good things to get to heaven. No, it's the blood of Jesus that sets you free. It's the blood of Jesus that denies all the evil one's claims on you. And if you don't have the blood of Jesus, the enemy still has claims over you and your body and your life and your future. You need the blood of Jesus that denies all the evil one's claims on you. So they got the Levites doing it, not the priests. Got the evangelists out there telling people, believe in Jesus and take your sins away. For there were many in the congregation that were not sanctified, therefore the Levites had to take charge of killing the Passover. Yeah, so everybody. Well, it was no longer the pastor who is announcing absolution. It was the deacons and the groundsmen and the guy who was sleeping the floor, was in love with Jesus, telling people, you know, Jesus died for that sin. It shouldn't bother you anymore. Place your faith in him. For the multitude of the people, even many of Ephraim and Manasseh, Issachar and Zebulun, had not cleansed themselves, yet they did eat the Passover otherwise than it was written. But Hezekiah prayed for them, saying, the good Lord pardon everyone, and that prepareth his heart to seek him, the Lord God of his fathers, though he be not cleansed, according to the purification of the sanctuary. And the Lord hearkened to Hezekiah and healed the people. Can you imagine that? Here's the king. The priests weren't ready, so he had to do the job. And he says, okay, Lord, you're going to have to do something because these people want to worship you, and they're not in the state of cleanness to worship you. So I'm going to tell them they just need to get sprinkled with your blood. And God says, okay, I heal them. By his wounds we are healed. Same as then, same as now. The Lord listened to Hezekiah. Yeah, why? Because Hezekiah is like, Lord, this is great. Revival is happening. We're changing this world. We're changing our country. We're going back to you. And here these people are not ready, but they're seeking you, Lord, just like I sought you, Lord. He says, okay, it will be sprinkled with my blood and sanctified just like you. The children of Israel that were present in Jerusalem kept the Feast of Unleavened Bread 7 days with gladness. And the Levites and the priests praised God day by day, singing with loud instruments unto the Lord. Okay, what's the next thing that happens? Gladness. Happiness. I mean, if you just, you could tell these people are just, you know, see them walking around and eyes are down and they got the muzzle over their face that they're told to and they can't go here and there. I mean, it's like a bunch of dogs who are being like they're beat up and, you know, like, you know. That's the way it is in America. Everywhere you look, you know. You need revival. You get revival and you get gladness. You have made me glad. Singing with loud instruments unto the Lord. Okay, it's not these, you know, there's, you know, when I was a Lutheran, I love these things that were written. Melchior Volupius, he was one of my favorite hymn writers. I mean, his stuff was dark, and it was in the minor key, and it was just so solemn, and it was just so much to God. And it wasn't happy. It was just, you know, there is a holy, righteous God, and I'm just so down and ugly and terrible in his sight. And, you know, have mercy on me. That was the best it can get. No, I'm not kidding. I really did like Melchior Volupius' stuff. I mean, his stuff was just, it was so reverent unto a holy God. But once revival happens, there's gladness, and there's loud instruments. Loud instruments! California's got these laws now, you know, if you're going to sing, you have to sing quietly, and you have to sing with a whisper, and you have to leave your mask on. Yeah. And oh, and the crazy stuff you got to do for Thanksgiving, you know, I mean, just, you could look it up. It's so ridiculous. They need revival big time. Where it broke out in the 70s, they need it big time now. You never know it was ever there. We need some loud music, some loud singing. And Hezekiah spake comfortably unto the Levites that taught the good knowledge of the Lord, and they did eat throughout the feast 7 days, offering peace offerings and making confession to the Lord, the God of their fathers. And he and the whole assembly took counsel to keep another 7 days, and they kept another 7 days with gladness. So what happens? Gladness and pleasantness and comfortableness. When you first go to church, you're uptight, and how do I look, and is somebody going to find out what's really going on in my mind and my heart and all? And now you got revival going on, and now what you got? This is God's people. These are my family. We're all going to praise God. This is just wonderful. This is amazing. Let's just extend the service another 7 days. That's what it says right here. They were having fellowship with God and fellowship with each other. And it's like, okay, another 7 days. I don't care about my business. This is revival. God showed up. Heaven came down. You read about any of these different experiences of some of the revivals that took place historically, and they talk about that. They talk about heaven coming down. That means that they can feel God's presence, and they can feel His joy, and they have God's peace, and they are just enjoying what God is doing. Sometimes the presence would come down during some of these revivals where the preacher wasn't preaching. He couldn't preach. He was overcome by emotion, and someone would stand up and give their testimony, and somebody else would stand up and give their testimony, and then somebody would break forth with a song. They didn't have to pull a hymnal out of the pulpit, and start singing. They just automatically, led by the Holy Spirit, start singing one hymn after another, and they didn't miss any verses. And the thing would go on for hours and hours, until finally, they're just kind of dismissing, and they're still singing as they're walking through the streets going home. That's revival. Now we got an hour and 15 minutes. That's it. You can't preach more than 45 minutes. It's like, because revival doesn't happen, you're going to follow these programs. Verse 24, for Hezekiah, king of Judah, did give to the congregation 1,000 bullocks and 7,000 sheep, and the princes gave the congregation 1,000 bullocks and 10,000 sheep, and a great number of priests sanctified themselves. And all the congregation of Judah, with the priests and the Levites and the congregation, came out of Israel, and the strangers that came out of the land of Israel that dwelt there rejoiced. There was great joy in Jerusalem, for since the time of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, there was not the like in Jerusalem. That's real revival, and they're rejoicing. And it's the king is like, hey, I got lots of cattle, let's go. And the priests are going, we got lots of cattle, let's go. You know, one thing that Calvary Chapel would do on Thanksgiving, they weren't having an offering to get lots of turkeys to give to the homeless. They gave the congregation turkeys. That's revival. It doesn't go from gimme, gimme, gimme from the pulpit on down. It's I'm going to give to you, I'm going to give to you. That's what revival looks like. It's the other way around, where God's people get taken care of. Verse 27, and the priests and Levites arose and blessed the people, and their voices was heard, and their prayer came up to His holy dwelling, even unto heaven. What happens now? God is hearing everybody's prayers. He's receiving it. Now when all this was finished, all Israel that were present went out to the cities of Judah and brake the images in pieces and cut down the groves and threw down the high places and the altars all out of Judah and Benjamin and Ephraim and Manasseh until they had utterly destroyed them all. And they and all the children of Israel returned every man to his possession into their city. So what's happening? Revival breaks out. And everybody is removing everything that could possibly bring anyone back under the dominion of Satan that they have been into. Breaking it down, destroying those things. And Hezekiah appointed the courses of the priests and the Levites after their courses, every man according to his service, the priests and the Levites for burnt offerings, for peace offerings, to minister, to give thanks, and to praise in the gates of the tents of the Lord. And he appointed also the king's portion of his substance for the burnt offerings, to wit, for the morning and evening burnt offerings, and the burnt offerings for the Sabbaths, and for the new moons, and for the set feasts that is written in the law of the Lord. Moreover, he commanded the people that dwell in Jerusalem to give the portion of the priests and the Levites, that they might be encouraged in the law of the Lord. And as soon as the commandment came abroad, the children of Israel brought in abundance the first fruits of corn and wine and oil and honey and the increase of the field, and the tithe of all the things brought them in abundantly. And concerning the children of Israel and Judah that dwelt in the cities of Judah, they also brought in the tithe of the oxen and the sheep and the tithe of the holy things which were consecrated unto the Lord their God, and laid them by heaps. Heaps. You know, people are, most religious things you listen to on the radio or on TV, and they're begging for money all the time. I mean, it's like, there's always something, even a good program, at the end, the announcer come on and say, you know, we are listener supported, blah, 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 give us your money. What happens with revival? people are giving you in heaps. Mm-hmm. In heaps. That's how it happens. Are you begging? You know, do you got the thermostat on the thermometer on the wall? You know, we're only here and we got to get there. We want to build this new piece of something or another. No, they just bring it in. They just, it's a normal thing. It's a change of a heart. And the heart is now in gratitude and the love of God and God's people. And concerning the children of Israel and Judah that dwell in the cities, they also brought tithes of the oxen, sheep. Okay. Third month, they also began to lay the foundation of the heaps and finished them the seventh month. And when Hezekiah and the princes came, they saw also the heaps. They blessed the Lord and his people. Then Hezekiah questioned with the priests and the Levites concerning the heaps. And Azariah, the chief priest of the house of Zadok, answered, says, since the people began to bring the offerings into the house of the Lord, we have had enough to eat and plenty, left plenty, for the Lord has blessed his people. And that which is left is great, is a great store. So the storehouses are getting filled. So now they can take care of the poor. They've taken care of their own ministry needs. And Hezekiah commanded to prepare the chambers in the house of the Lord. And they prepared them, so they got places to store all this stuff. And they brought the offerings and the tithes and the dedicated things faithfully over, which Koinonia the Levite was ruler, and Shimei his brother was next. And Jehiel and Azaziah and Nahath and Hazael and Jeremoth and Jozabad and Eliel and Ishmashiah and Mahath and Benaniah were overseers over the hand of Koinonia and Shimei's brothers at the commandment of Hezekiah the king and Azariah the ruler of the house of God. And Korah the son of Imnah the Levite, the porter towards the east, was over the freewill offerings to distribute the oblations of the Lord and the most holy things. And next to him were Eden and Minaniam and Jeshua and Sheminiah and Amariah and Shechaniah and the cities of the priests and their set offers to give their brethren by courses as well as to great and small. So what's happening now? The priesthood is now being financially supported, if you want to put it that way. They're fine, which means they don't have to have their own job to support what they're doing to minister unto the Lord and his people. Now they are being supplied to do so. Besides their genealogy of man from 3 years old and upward, even unto everyone that entered into the house of the Lord, his daily portion for their service and their charge according to their courses. Both of the genealogy of their priests by the house of their fathers, and the Levites from 20 years old upwards and their charge by their courses. And that's how David had set it up. And to the genealogy of their little ones and their wives and their sons and their daughters throughout the congregation, for in their set office they sanctify themselves in holiness. Also the sons of Aaron, the priests, which were in the fields of the suburbs of their cities and every several city, the men that were expressed by name to give portions, and all the males among the priests to all those who were reckoned by genealogies among the Levites. So now all the people who were there, that are their job is to worship the Lord and to teach his word and so on, they're now all being supported because the results of the revival. And thus did Hezekiah throughout all Judah and wrought that which was good and right and truth before the Lord his God. And in every work that he began in service of the house of God and in the law and in the commandments to seek his God, he did it with all of his heart and prospered. Okay. That sounds great. Wonderful. This is what revival looks like. But I have to say that after revival happens, there is going to be tests. And so the next chapters is going to be the conflict that happens from the next king of Assyria, Sennacherib. As he has completely devastated the northern tribes, he's now at Judah. And he's starting to take out some of the cities of Judah. Now, God absolutely was blessing Hezekiah and Judah for their obedience. But he is allowing them to see a life and death situation coming their way. Why? Because a faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. There's got to be some tests. These are life and death threats. These are huge. So you've got this gigantic country who is able to wipe out one country after the next. They're in charge, and they're coming after Judah. And so we've read before the thing of Sennacherib, and you got Rabshakeh, and he's threatening, and you know they're right there at the wall of Jerusalem, and they're saying it in Hebrew so that everybody is hearing these very discouraging words. And they're actually saying, well, you know, because of all these so-called reforms that Hezekiah did, he's making all the other gods that live here angry, so you're not going to win. So all these horrible things to really say, do I really trust God or I don't trust God or what's going on? A faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. And so what happens? Well, God shows up strong on his behalf. He sends a prophet and he says, they're going to be taken away. They're going to be distracted, go somewhere else. Okay, well, that happens. They go and think that, you know, the Ethiopians are going to come and wipe them. And so now they're going to come back, and now they're going to focus their attention on destroying Jerusalem. So then he takes this thing and he puts all these threats on a scroll, rolls it out in the temple before the Lord, and he says, Lord, this is what happens. And God sends his prophets to go talk to Hezekiah. And what happens that night? God sends an angel, just any old angel. What can any old angel do? Wipe out 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. And they woke up and they found all these people dead. They woke up dead. Yeah, quite interesting. All these people were going to attack Jerusalem, where God is, where God manifest presence is. And they were wiped out. Assyria didn't mess around with Judah anymore. And then the king goes home. And then he gets killed by his two sons. And then you get the next king that shows up. Okay, that's a big testing. And then you have God showing up strong with this big testing. And what does that do? It just encourages your trust in God and encourage you to do what God said before you. And that's a continuation of revival. But it comes with a big test. But then what's the next thing? The personal test. What happened after this? Hezekiah's got cancer. I mean, they call it a boil. But he's going to die. And he's praying to God. And he turns his face to the wall because he's stuck in bed. He's going to die. He says, Lord, you know, I've done everything. I've done whatever it is. And then God says, Isaiah, come here. You go talk to him. Okay? I've heard your prayer. I'm going to heal you. Take a poultice of figs and put it right over that oil, right over that cancer. And he got healed. And he says, okay, now ask God for a sign. And so look out the window. What do you see? Well, there's, you know, my old man's sundial out there. Says, okay. You want to see a change? Go forward or backward? Well, it's going to go back forward anyway. I want to see it go backward. Okay, that'll be a sign from God that you're going to be healed. So, sundial goes backwards, which means what? In order for the sundial to go backwards, it means the sun in its rotation has got to go the other direction. Well, how did that happen? We don't know. But we also know that there's an issue between the lunar calendar and the solar calendar, which means there is... We don't have 360 days in a year. We have 365 days, or 64 and a quarter, or whatever it is. There's a problem. Well, here's one of the reasons why there was a problem. Because God is going to show himself to Hezekiah so that he was going to trust him. Sundial went backwards. Okay, all that to say, the next test is Hezekiah personally. So we can be a part of a revival, and there can be a big test for everybody, and God's going to show himself strong, and God's going to just do an amazing thing, and God's going to pour out prosperity and all the things that he did for Hezekiah and for Judah. And then God's going to go, okay, what about you? Do you really trust me? Do you personally trust me? And we're going to individually, everyone who's individually a part of a revival is going to get that individual test, life or death. Do you trust me? This is all part of revival. Is it real or is it not real? Is it real because I got the gladness, because we have a good time with fellowship, because we're rejoicing with all the loud instruments? Or am I just really enjoying going to church and having a nice, beautiful worship service? Am I enjoying all the niceties of church? Am I enjoying all the niceties of everything that fellowship has to offer? Or is my relationship with God real? Am I really going to trust him? So I'm just going quickly through this, but these are absolutely other aspects of revival. And that's for a person who's involved in revival. And it's going to come to you personally. And if you read some of these stories and some of the people who God used in different revivals or in what you would call successful ministries where lots of people are getting saved, Every last one of them has had some kind of life and death kind of thing, or a death of a child, or a death of a spouse, or, you know, their own personal cancer report, or whatever case may be, because God wants to keep them humble. Well, Hezekiah, at the end, still got another test from him. You know, God gave him a really nice promise. Okay, you're not going to die. You got 15 more years. So in those 15 more years, where God is not going to destroy Judah because of their sin, he does a lot of things to make Jerusalem strong against the attack that he knows is going to happen. And they build this tunnel and let the water come through and all these kind of cool things, and add to the walls and add to the fortifications, all kinds of things. He's doing lots of things for his country. But then he gets his test. And it says that the Spirit leaves him so that the Lord can find out what's really on his heart. And what was the test? Oh, here's some ambassadors, this faraway country called Babylon. They want to come and visit you and bring you some presents because they heard you were sick and you got better. So what does he do? Oh, this is great. Let me show you all these neat treasures that we have here. And what did those two guys do? They took inventory. Those things got recorded. And the king of Babylon's son at some point is going to come across those records and go, huh, I guess I could take that stuff too. Well, what happened after Hezekiah? He had a son whose name was Manasseh, and Manasseh did such bad things, and all the revival that had just taken place was totally turned around, and they were once again burning their children to Moloch. I mean, every worst, heinous thing that people could come up with, it happened during Manasseh's reign. And God says, because of what you did, there's a curse. You know, and judgment is going to come. Well, there was another son from Manasseh, and his name was Josiah, and he took things seriously. And there was another revival during Josiah's time. And when Josiah died, that was pretty much the end of Judah, because the revival stopped at his death. And I say that because often revival stopped at the end of the life of the man through whom God used. So Hezekiah died, revival stopped. Then there was Josiah. Once again, another revival. They found the law, they found the book, all these things happened again. When he died, Jehoiakim was so bad that there was a curse on the line of David. So by the time the Savior was to be born, the one Shiloh to whom it belongs, the one who was going to be born king of the Jews, the line was cursed all the way down to Solomon. So it's still going to be a son of David, but it wasn't going to be through Solomon, who's going to end up in Jeconiah. It's going to come through Nathan, a completely different son of David. And Mary was descended from Nathan and not from Solomon. Now, legally, Joseph was descended from Solomon. So legally, Jesus was king of the Jews. But biologically, Jesus is Messiah, king of the Jews, through Nathan and not Solomon, David's son, from Mary, Jesus' mother. So all that to say, they listened, and the Lord relented concerning the doom which he had pronounced against them. And when they listened, they turned to God. What happens when people turn to God? God turns to us. When you turn to God, and you seek him with all of your heart, he will be found by you. Revival starts. Revival happens. Revival continues. As long as people are in the Word, it'll continue. But revival is brittle. It's delicate. It can be broken. All it takes is another leader who wants to turn people back to the things of Satan. All the stuff that happened through this last revival, California, all these young people all got saved. They were camping out on the beaches in Southern California. Now what do we got in Southern California? Can't sing in church, doors are closed. You know, you got a couple of pastors who are breaking the law and getting fined heavily, and some of them are in prison, some of them are getting fined heavily for worshiping anywhere. Also in Southern California, it's very sad. Revival is an important thing, and the only way we can continue it is to continue to be under the authority of the Holy Spirit, and the words of the Holy Spirit has already written down through his men. It's called Bible. It's the only way it can happen. Lord Jesus, we just ask for revival, Lord. We ask that you once again turn back the captivity, Lord, that you bring back those folks who are in apostate churches and bring them back to you. We ask you, Lord, that you revive your people. And regardless of what pastors are ready or not, Lord, use the people who are sanctified, who are already wholly yours, in instruments to bring about this revival. Lord, you choose the foolish things. You choose the things that nobody has any regard for. And you use them because they know it's going to be all you and not them. And the world's going to know that it's all you and it's not them. Lord, use us. Prepare us. Let us be in a state of holiness. And it's your will, as Paul tells the Thessalonians chapter 4, your will is our sanctification, us being set apart for you and for you only. Lord, help us be there and stay there and be ready for the people who are going to come our way when you start moving and pouring out your Spirit. Lord, we ask for revival. First for us, then the church, then our country. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.